now, we fix free, but whoops. For those of you not familiar with the rules of the show, my lovely, extremely gorgeous, most talented, and highly intelligent, former Miss World, Sailor, even I can't believe it, Sock, will explain.
Well, Graham, we have chosen three contestants from our studio audience. One map of the world and 25 flags per contestant.
Yes, Sailor, the object of the game is to pinpoint the flag to the country. Pinpoint the flag. You know, pinpoint. Can I have three volunteers from the audience, please? Don't all rush at once. Three volunteers, please. Any three? Random? Let's see who's out there.
Yeah. Thank you. morning, everyone, and a very warm welcome to you all, and especially to our visitors this morning. This morning's special event, seeing the world through rose-coloured stained windows, is looking at the issue of culture and how people of different cultures relate to each other. A culture is made up of many elements. Some of them we can easily see, such as our dress or behaviours, or customs that we follow. And there are other things that are less visible, such as language, our ideas, and our values. But all these work together to make up what we call culture. And it's in understanding these things that we begin to understand each other. So this morning, I'd like you to sit back and enjoy our multicultural presentation.
Thank you. in the brochure. I want a full refund when I get back to the hotel.
About people from all over the world singing out. So if you'd like to stand, please stand.
Thank you. just like to encourage you to pass the bag along to the next person. We don't expect that you put anything into the bags. We're committed as a fellowship to giving, and if you'd just like to pass that bag along to the next person, that'd be great. Again, I want to reiterate the welcome you got this morning. It's been an interesting event so far. Hopefully more interesting things to come. Just like while that bag's going around now, I'll just pray for the offering, and then I'll carry on with some announcements. So we can just pray. Father God, we thank you for your abundance. Lord, we thank you for your provision, and now we just give some of that back to you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
So after the event this morning, there'll be a cup of tea out the back. We'd like to invite you, if you're a visitor especially, to join us for a cup of tea and some conversation. It'd be really nice to get to know you a little bit better. It's an interesting thing when you look at culture. I come from England. I've lived in New Zealand for most of my life. And most of that I lived in the South Island. And it's an amazing thing that you can have within the same country completely different cultural perspectives, even though you were brought up in what you thought was a multicultural environment. When I came to Porirua from Christchurch, it was quite different from what I was used to. And it took me a wee while to get used to it. But now, after living here for 3 years, it's interesting. When I go back to Christchurch now, I have problems down there. So I go to a place like my old church that I used to go to in Christchurch, and it's amazing. It's just, we don't have the diversity down there that we have here. So I go in there and I'm looking for a bit of colour, and there isn't any. It's all white. It's disappointing, I've got to tell you. We're very fortunate to live in a place where we are touched by so many different cultures. And it's a real privilege, and I think it's something that that Porirua has that perhaps no other part of the country has. And I think we're very privileged to be amongst that. So be encouraged. Just like you to sit back and enjoy the rest of the show.
I think I can improve it. You know, it's been said that everything's all white. But I noticed every time I look out, when I'm in the South Island, that everybody's all slightly off colour, slightly pink. I don't know where they get this white idea from. Some time ago, I saw a sign that somebody tongue-in-cheek had placed on the side wall of a hall in the Akatarawas. I guess it's all right for me to read it because of my colour. It said this. It said, "You Europeans say we're coloured, but you're usually off-white. When you get cold, you turn blue. When you get a fright, you get goosebumps and you turn stone white. When you get seasick, you turn green. When you are scared, you are said to be yellow. When you are embarrassed, you turn red. And when you get flushed, you turn pink. When you die, you go dark. And you call us coloured." You know, it's interesting. Civil disobedience, marches, demonstrations, and ethnic wars. We are so hardened that it almost seems normal that those things are happening. Sorry, guys. Newspapers, TV, radios are all filled and blaring almost daily with riots, violence, rape, and racial conflict. Governments spend millions on social action to protect their own race. Others spend millions generating war to protect their own views. And so what are we all about? No government, no agency, no people, no one. No one can agree. Not in reality, not on everything. How do we solve the problems that we face? How do we solve the problems of cultural diversity? And that diversity is not simply the colour of your skin. You see, my glasses I'm wearing here this morning are kind of helping me see a good perspective of you. We've almost got it right. The trouble is the guy who was white, he's gone black. And the guy who's brown, he's really hard to toast. And he's still not much browner than he was. I guess the best way is to get them both looking the same. You know, it doesn't matter who we are, the governments around the world, the parties who are in leadership, propose a view and the opposition have to find an alternative. And usually the alternative is diametrically so different so that they can stand out that people in the end get injured. And every quarter there are arguments. They're heated. The debates run wild. You only need to listen to our politicians in New Zealand to see it. You look at what's happening at the moment. And I'm not siding with any party. I think New Zealand's got a major problem. At the moment, it strikes me, and I'm saying this from a European perspective, it's a white pick on anybody with a Māori skin in government because they happen to be identified with a particular party, and it's vicious and it's nasty. Looks like we've got some improvement.
Not enough.
Bunch more.
Take them around.
Bunch more.
society generate a kind of poverty and a sameness. Thing is, as I always know, white people seem to burn in the sun quicker. We face a poverty of life, a poverty of spirit, a poverty financially, and we end up with a whole bunch of people who are feeling so mixed up, so frustrated, and so angry. Some of them get impassioned with a desire for revenge. And that's what our society is largely about. So I think we need to, in coming to a place where we can truly celebrate the diversity of our cultures, we need to ask some questions. I want to ask this question this morning. What is it that tends in us to, for us to continue as humans on a destructive course? You see, we toast each other in all sorts of peculiar ways. I want some volunteers. We're in for volunteers this morning. I'd like some volunteers. Anybody who likes playing cards. I've got to have some that are, I'll allow one around the age of under 15, and the others have all got to be over that. I'll take one of these guys here. Man, it's a hard choice. We'll go junior this time. Hey, come with some older ones. I want a couple of older ones. I want a big beefy guy. Oh, here we are. Marilyn. She's not a guy. She's a woman with respect. Let's give her a hand. Come on. Solid beefy guy in the Koro. Yeah, we'll let Koro all this time. We'll let John come. No, we've got a man coming. Now, I don't know whether you've ever heard the card song. Have you heard the card song? The soldier who had a pack of cards.
Yeah, I know that.
Well, I figured you guys are a little blind because most of us have a little bit of blindness. We don't see things very well when we look at other people. So what I did, I decided this pack of cards wasn't a good pack of cards for our people to play with. That this can't see well enough. Marilyn proves that. She just had to get some new glasses. So what I did is I made some cards. And what I want to do here is I want to shuffle the cards. I want to get these guys to pick a card or two. All right. What I'd like you to do is to pick a card. Here we go. Pick a card. Pick a card. Pick a card. Okay, let's have a look at your card. What have you got? Well, I've got blank faces, and he got a blank. Who wins?
He does.
They win because they got blank aces.
We got
an
eight.
You got a. Well, that's an ace. Eight. All right, here we go. Alright, you can pick another card now. Come on, let's have a card. Here we go. Let's turn him over again. Show the group. He's got the ace of what? An ace of noses. Let's give it to him. Yeah. Never heard of this before, but what have you got? The ace of spades. Man, you're in trouble, aren't you? He keeps drawing blanks. Oh, let's give him another shot. We'll give him first choice this time. Give him first choice. What's he got? What's he got? We've got to see what he's got straight. Ah, oh, there's his spade. He's got no blank. All right, we're going to draw one more card each. Oh, what have you got there? What are they? Smell. let's see it. Oh, no! How could you do it? Let's give him a hand for that. All right, it's your choice. What did you get? He got another strip plan. Go, let's give him a hand. Now, notice this. Marilyn's got the ace of runny noses. And we did well because we ended up with another blank. But you know what? Did you notice something peculiar about this? This is like playing the card games that go in gambling centres. You know, people draw the card and they get the card they get. And they hope they're going to win. And that's kind of like life. You see, Marilyn ended up with smelly feet. And a runny nose. Went away. We got a... Junior, he got a... A hairy, pointed nose. See, notice hers. Hers is more like Manu's. This one's more like... I did shave it this morning. You see, when you get down to it, all of us, when we get our deal, if we had a choice about it, we would prefer to have the ace of hearts. You see, we would prefer to have the ace of hearts. When we drew our lot in life, we'd prefer to have the ace of hearts. But some of us get smelly feet and runny noses. My poor wife, she gets colds all the time. Terrible. You try kissing a wife when she's got a cold. Just as bad trying to kiss a man when he's got a unshaven face. You know, folks, we don't have much choice about the way we're born. We don't have much choice about the shape of our noses. And we're hoping to draw this, but can I suggest something to you? That we don't need to draw into this. We can actually draw on this, and I want to talk about that this morning. And I want to give these guys a hand.
Lovely little hearts.
You know, Joe enjoyed going to school from that day on. You know why? They suddenly realised there was something special. They liked to play with her hair. She was the only one with fair hair. Her hair was special, suddenly. She became special. And she loved some of those kids in that class. They got along really well, some of them did. But I never forget, just shortly afterwards, my wife went to pick Adele up from class, and she went to the door of the class, and she was waiting there, and the anticipation for the class to finish just beside the door, and the teacher looked out the door and looked back and says, "Adele, your mother's out here, out there." She stood there and said, thought, "How on earth does she know that I'm Adele's mother?" Suddenly a penny dropped. There it was. You see, we can't help but notice, can we? All of us. And I remember when I was at school, I told the Whitey story. I think in horror of a young girl we went to school with who happened to have a coloured skin from a particular race. And we called her Maggoty. Her surname was Smith. We used to call her Maggoty Smith. And the only reason we called her that I can remember or perceive, I don't even know why it started. It's because she had a coloured skin and nobody else did in our class. That's bad. I kind of think it would be good. I have this philosophy that we should all be issued with purple glasses, with all sorts of squiggles and lines and so we can't see properly, and then we wouldn't know what the other person was. We'd only be able to know what the other person was by knowing the other person. And that would change our perspectives. Well, it'd probably give us very painful eyes, but never mind. It would at least give us a new perspective. You see, there was a perspective years ago where God had made people. And there was a group of people, not every person that lived on the earth, as is popularly believed by some. There was a group of people that said, "Let's build a tower, and we'll reach up to the heavens, and we'll become like God." God looked at it and shook his head and thought, "Man, if they keep this up, this is not going to be good. This is not going to be good." So what he did is he got them and he separated them, sent them all over the place, gave them different languages. I don't know how he did it, whether he just got them into conflict in such a way that they ended up speaking different languages, or what happened exactly, or how it happened. But I do know one thing, the end product was that they were separated and they were no longer bugging God with this problem. The trouble is, they continued to blow it again. "Why do I do what I do?" Some of the people I imagine would have said. "Why do I keep doing the things I do? Why do I get particular perspectives?" And it's not just in terms of different colours. It's in terms of different groups. White collars and blue collars. Socioeconomic differences. Sometimes it does come down simply to the way your face or your nose looks for some people. "I don't like that person, I distrust them." I said to one person a while ago, "Why do you distrust them? You've got a funny looking face." Might be true. But I always figured that if you look in the mirror, there's another one looks at you too. Huh? Gotta have a sense of humour about it. In the Bible, God talks about this kind of attitude, this kind of thing that we have, and he calls it sin. It's a simple word for it, but the meaning of it means to be in rebellion to what God intended. To be in rebellion would be that I would criticise, attack, or in some way malign or think lowly of you. Or even possibly on some occasions to think too highly of you. Rationally we'll say, "Look, we can stop this. I can stop this kind of attitude and my diversity and my cultural diversity. We can try." I used to try. I failed. Like to ask you, how many people have made New Year's resolutions and you've not been able to keep them? How many people have honestly done that in the past? Come on, be honest. Honesty. All right. How many people have totally succeeded every time they've done it? Oh dear. You see, our New Year's resolutions that people make, I've decided it's not a wise thing to make New Year's resolutions. You're safer, you don't tend to make any more mistakes on making them. But New Year's resolutions, they're there because we recognise there's something we need to do that we haven't done. And often, they're things that we know are wrong things that we tend to do. And so we struggle and we fail. And it's proven by what we've done here this morning. It's not the fact that you commit sin or I commit sin or whatever that makes us a sinner. That's not what makes us a sinner, the fact that we do it. It's not like that at all. The problem we have is that we are sinners and that's why we commit sin. It's the opposite way around. You see, if we come from the first side of the thing, we're going to say, I'm going to solve this thing. I'm going to be better at coping when I'm in different cultural setting with other people, or different setting, and it may not be just a racial cultural setting. Some of the wars that have gone on in the world right now are people who have originally, if you go back in history, had the same great, 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 great grandparents, but they can't get along today. Paul, who is probably one of the greatest Christians in history, he said something out of sheer frustration. He said, the very thing I want to do is the very thing I do not do. And Paul, of all people, understood the racial issue. We tend to focus on the areas of difference with others. We tend to focus on their strengths and their weaknesses, and we tend to try and nitpick on them. I don't know how many of you saw the TV thing last night. I saw a part of it, the boat race between Oxford and Cambridge in England. They are two totally different cultures, both groups mainly white. Totally different cultures. Their environment is powerful. And they row 4 and a bit miles every year in one race. They row this race and they sweat and they spend 6 months, early mornings, preparing for this race. And at the end of the race, Oxford hung its head low for the fifth time. They lost the game. And the kind of despair that was there. And the other guys were happy and celebrating. You know, it was one thing that stood out in the whole thing. Nobody from Cambridge went over and says, it's all right, mate. You lost, it doesn't matter. Guess they might have thought that that might have been a bit too much. I don't know. I remember when I was in college in Auckland years ago, I'd picked up this foot infection, and I had had it for some time. I just thought I had smelly feet. I thought that you were either born with them or you weren't born with them, you know? I remember sitting in a room, a common room one day. I was so embarrassed because the student leader turned around in this particular room and says, who's the guy with the stinking feet? Did I feel small? I felt like I wanted to sort of disappear through the floor and sort of shame. I'd washed my feet, I'd scrubbed my feet, and little did I realise that actually created an even bigger problem with the complaint that I had. It took a while. I finally went to the doctor, and I said to the doctor while I was here, I said, I've got this terrible problem with my feet smelling. Is there something I could do to sort of help it smell a bit better? You know, is there something you could put on them that makes them smell better? Apart from putting perfume on them, because I tried that. It didn't work, just made things worse. And the doctor said to me, look, my feet. He says, you've got an infection there. This is easy, he says. Just get some of the stuff and put it on your feet. So I did. I thought, marvellous. At last I solved the problem. The only trouble is it didn't work. And everywhere I went, can you imagine what it was like? How am I today? I didn't want to go into small rooms with people because, boy, you get exposure. And then a chemist said to me, that stuff doesn't work. I don't know why the doctor gave me that stuff. I've got some better stuff here. They gave me this little wee bottle, and it just looked so stupidly small. I picked it. How on earth was this kind of stuff going to work? The chemist said to me, just put a couple of drops on and just rub it around. Wash your hands afterwards, and it'll be fine. It took about 2 weeks, and I could go take my socks off and... They look good. Now you're only going on because you've all got smelly feet. You know what yours smell like, I don't.
We just know what yours smell like.
Oh. See, for me, I was oppressed by the very thing that was a part of me. I was oppressed because I wondered what others would think. And I had no sense of freedom when I was in the midst of groups of people. If I was inside and heading for a small room, I was worried. Now, in actual fact, most times, most people didn't notice. This guy who noticed me that time, I think, must have had a very good nose. Well, maybe not too good a nose, but never mind. We're biased in all sorts of ways. Smelly feet, whatever. Do you know, for some people, that smelly feet in some cultures means that you're a great hero? You know that? Do you know, for the nomadics, they have all sorts of things like this. Some of the nomadic peoples, they have some interesting stories to tell. You go and eat with the nomadics, and you eat your meal, and you sit there really politely at the end of it, and you say, thank you very much, that was a lovely meal. And nomadic, you know what some of the nomadic tribes do? They'll shoot you. Because what you're meant to do, at the end of a meal, is go... And the longer and the louder you can go and drop a burp, the greater the meal was for you. That's what you're saying to them. You're saying, with this great big burp, thank you doesn't say it. The burp says thank you in the utmost degree, and they are really proud of the fact they fed you well. If you can burp the loudest and the longest, you are really well liked. I don't know whether you'd sort of go for it, but tell you what, I certainly would burp if I knew that I was going to be in danger. The other thing that happens with one of the nomadic groups, and in fact I believe there's more than one, but I know one culture group that has the thing where when you go for the meal, you're expected, you are expected, and if you don't do it yourself, they will help you to do it, you're expected to take the eyes out of the pot, and they are the ultimate or tasty delicacy. And you're meant to take the eye, and you're meant to put it on your plate, and you're meant to savour it. You're not allowed to slip it down and go, just to get rid of it. You've got to make a show of the fact that you're going to eat it, and you're going to eat it slowly. The thought gets to me. If you do that, you're acceptable, but if you don't, you're not. You see, we have all sorts of very, very arbitrary kind of thoughts. I wonder who created that whole thing. I wonder if the first guy who made his friends eat an eye thought it was a huge joke and started a trend. I mean, I only need to look at some of the clothes some of the people around here wear, and I think, boy, some of these designers have got a real sense of humour. But there are things we cannot change. There are things we cannot change. Our noses, our colour, our bodies. Well, you can do it temporarily, like the lady in America, and there's also a man that's done it. They painted their skin brown, had the pigment changed. And you know, an interesting thing happened. They said, when they were walking around, when they were white, they were great. When they were brown, they were treated like dirt. Well, I don't like the term white because I don't think we're white at all. I think we're pink. I think we're not white because when we think of ourselves as white, if we're Europeans, Europeans have tended to think of themselves as pure. So much so that there's a Mormon doctrine that's preached that they pretend doesn't exist, but it's there. You can prove it in writing. It says this. It says, if you become a Mormon, a true follower of Mormonism, and you've got a coloured skin, that your skin will change to white. That's what they preach. Now, the present day Mormons, they don't do it. They don't preach it nowadays. But that's what was taught, because some Europeans had this real arrogant attitude about themselves. It wasn't good. We favour things. You know Mr. Bean? You know what makes Mr. Bean funny? He's one of the saddest guys around. He's found it so hard to cope with the image that's come about. You know what he does? He simply picks on the natural, normal things of life and he amplifies them. That's all he does. He can make unlocking a car funny. He can make diving off of a diving board absolutely hilarious. As you see him come to the edge of the diving board, and all the things that we think and feel and don't actually do. I remember one of the times I went off the high diving board in the Olympic pool in Blenheim. First time I went off the pool, I went on the edge. You know what I wanted to do? I wanted to creep back off, but I was up there, you know. Heroes don't back off. So I'm standing on the edge. I'm like this inside. Mr. Bean, he stands here, does this. He doesn't even do that. I remember the film he did on, he got down on his stomach and he crawled out into the pool and he looked down. And in the end, instead of diving, you know the story? He slips off the end, he's hanging on with his fingers. He's hanging on there. He's looking down, he's hanging on. He's desperately hanging on. And in the end, this young fellow who wanted to dive off the diving board had been watching, got sick of it, and came over and stopped on his feet. And he dived, feet first. You know, we are different, and we need to be thankful for that. If you were all the same as me, oh man. But if we were all the same as you, oh terrible! You know what I'm saying? We are diverse and we need to appreciate it. God certainly does. He made us like that. He made us diverse in all sorts of ways. And he wants us to realize it's not a case of the throwing of a dice and us having bad luck because we didn't get the number we wanted. This dice is a really good one because it's got an 8 on it. I like it. I like to get the 8. It's not a case of that. It's a case of appreciating that whatever we've got, that we've got the best. And knowing that for sure, and not allowing anybody else to rob us from that. You see, the passage that was read from Acts chapter 10 by Adele this morning says this. When Peter was mixing with Cornelius, he was a Gentile and considered to be the worst by the Jews. They would always want to clean themselves for 7 days before they could go back to the temple, the church of their day, after they'd been with the Gentile. Peter began to speak after God had brought him along to this place. And he didn't want to go because God kept giving him this vision of a sheep being lyred with all sorts of animals that he wouldn't touch as a Jew. And Gentiles ate them, and so they were dirty. They were really dirty. Gentiles is a dirty word. And God sent him along to this house, and it was after he was there for a while, he said this. I now realize how true it is that God does not show any favoritism, but accepts men from every nation who fear him and do what is right. Now, I really love that passage. That means that I can celebrate the fact that there's no favoritism, that we're all the same in the eyes of God. And his intention is that we can be all the same in the eyes of each other if we allow it to happen. Martin Luther King got it right in his I Had a Dream sermon. One point, I can't remember the exact wording, but he said something like this. He says, I have a dream that one day my two little children will hold hands and walk down the street with two little white children. That they'll be able to play with each other. That was his dream. In a time of segregation when they couldn't even live in the same street, go to the same toilets, ride the same buses. Martin Luther King spoke out as a man who understood who God was about. He was a pastor and a man impassioned by God. What a sense of purpose he had. In spite of everything, he would look and he would see the goodness in the persons who were persecuting him. And that's the same way that Jesus views us, and he viewed the ones who killed him. See, God got it worked out. You know, he made us different shapes, not that we would criticize each other. He made some of us with blank minds at the time. At times, I went to cell group the other night. I was trying to remember what I preached on Sunday. Can't believe it. But I can tell you what happened 3 years ago, or 20 years ago. Just the way I work, I'm different. I'm no good at doing memory verses like some Christians have, or remembering things on a short term. But you get me 10 years later after I've learnt it, and I've still got it. I don't know how it happens, it's the way I'm made. We might be satisfied with the ace of diamonds, you know, riches in this world. Can I suggest to you that that's not everything? In fact, can I suggest to you that that's a low card? That's a really low card. Because the ace of hearts will always beat it. The ace of hearts is... Well, several of you tilted your heads when I did that, so I've got a bit of a right. The ace of hearts is what it's all about. If we can learn to love, if we can be impassioned by our love for one another the way that God wants us to be, we've got a real reason to celebrate. You know, there's 25 flags up there. Those 25 flags represent the people that are in this church, and I'm sure with some of the others that are here this morning, it probably enlarges that. It's not that we're all full-blooded. I mean, it always amuses me. I'm a European. Yeah? Well, so is Tepa. But we never tell him he's a European, he's Māori. And some of the others, I mean, we always know Manu is Samoan. But his mum wasn't Samoan. Rosella. And Helen and Samoan. But their mum's as English as you can ever get. You saw her out here this morning. She's pink. I'm Romney Gypsy, if you want to get down to it. That's my background. Well, that's the part I want to own. Not because of the rebellious part, but because it's a very, very famous man called Gypsy Smith who really, his life affected the whole of Europe as a Christian. You may not have heard of him because he was quite a few years ago that he lived. But we can celebrate. We can celebrate if we're living with the heart of God, if we know what his heart is. And he says that he loves us all and he doesn't hold, what was it? He doesn't in any way hold any favoritism against us. Or for us. He accepts us as we are and treats us equally. And so I think we've got a real sense, a real reason to celebrate. When Manu and Nat said to me that this is a service they want to do on celebrating cultural diversity, I thought, oh no, what a nightmare. I mean, you imagine trying to prepare a message and know what you're going to come to? But the more I thought about it, I thought the reason it's a nightmare is because we find it hard to face our differences sometimes. And I want to encourage you this morning that if we have a good, solid relationship with God, that is the only way we're going to stop being like we are. We can't stop sinning because by nature we are sinners, as I quoted earlier. We can't stop. In any sin where we have a bias against or overly for another person, overemphasizing in one direction or another, then we are in sin. And God wants to liberate us from it. From that. He wants us to be able to get up here like the people did this morning and give a greeting in their own language and to be able to say this and for us, and I was so pleased with you, how you appreciated that this morning. You gave a hand. I want to say to you, I think that's marvellous that you could show appreciation for each other's culture and the diversity that we have in this community in Porirua and in New Zealand, in this world. And I pray that you'll discover the depths of what that's like to have the heart of God the way that God would want. I would close this place as close to my heart and say, "No, God, be close to my heart every moment of my life. Because when you are, you change me for the better, and I can celebrate the life I live with my neighbours and friends." I was looking at Susan yesterday. Susan's probably going to kick me like a mother did before. But something happened. You know, she came to know Jesus just a few weeks ago.
Amen.
And I was watching her, and I thought, you know, already I've seen this beauty come out in Susan, an even stronger way than she's ever shown it before. And I'm saying that not because I want Susan to feel I'm giving her a pat on the back, but because I'm wanting us to realise that when God touches our life, He really does change us. And He changes us from the inside out. And He gets to the outside as well. And we can appreciate that. Let's celebrate our cultural diversity. And I'm going to lead us in a prayer this morning. If you'd like to join me with this prayer, I'd invite you to. Father God, we want to acknowledge that at times we have sinned in our attitudes towards other people. We have at times done wrong in holding grudges against people, whether it's because of the different colours that we have, or the different attitudes that we have, or the personalities and nature and character that are in others. Lord God, cause us to be people who are going to be like you, who doesn't look at the colour, the creed, doesn't look at the character and condemn us, but you look at us. You look at us in a way that says, "I want you. I want you to be redeemed. I want you to be free." Lord, we want to, this morning, some of us here want that freedom. And we want to say sorry for the times when we have offended you because we have not liked what you have created. Help us. Lord, we know in principle that if we have a right attitude towards other people and we encourage and help them, that they'll often change, but sometimes we just don't even bother. So guide us and show us that we might be real people the way you designed us to be, and not just people who are being conformed by the shaping of opinions and attitudes of this society. Help us to be people that are after your heart, that are knowing you and loving you. We accept, Lord Jesus, that when you died on the cross, you died for all nations, and not just for some people. So help us to know what that means in everyday life, in Jesus' name. And all the people said,
Amen.
Lord bless you. Let's show an appreciation to the team.